December.
I know. Well, it's 60 degrees out, so.
That is a good point.
Doesn't make it hard, yeah.
That's a good point. We walked over here to the Billings Public Library with no coats on. It's so nice outside. So, yeah, what do you want for Christmas this year?
Well, I hadn't thought of myself, but I have thought of a lot of fun things for the kids.
Yeah, it's going to be really fun this year shopping for Christmas. There's so many cool things out.
Yeah.
Have you thought about, though, if you could have one thing, what would it be?
Like a tech thing?
Or non-tech thing. What's on your list?
I haven't thought about it, actually. What about you guys?
I don't know. My laptop is sort of fading away, so we'll see. Maybe a gift to myself might be something like that, but we'll see.
So if you were to buy yourself a big computer gift, I mean, that's kind of a big gift. What would you get?
Well, I'm a Mac guy, so I'd have to get a MacBook Pro.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll see if there's any end-of-the-year deals maybe I can jump in on. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, sometimes those prices drop right before the end of the calendar year.
So. Yeah, we'll see. I haven't really thought too much about it. It would be nice to have something like a membership to the Y. Mm-hmm. We talked about something like that, a family gift.
Cool.
Yeah, we've seen some cool things.
Yeah.
First off, instead of who's who and what they do this week, what's what and what does it do?
Any order, right? Oh, dang it.
I've been taking it around everywhere I go.
Yeah.
And trying it different things out with different classrooms to see how it could be used in schools. I mean, not even just how it could be used with your kids at home, but if you order now and you're not in a hurry to get it before Christmas, you can get it for $15 off.
Ooh.
So I bought one for myself.
Yeah.
Did you?
Christmas Eve? I did.
I did too, actually.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, I guess I need to jump on the bandwagon.
Well, what's really cool from a teaching perspective is, like, with the Words app, you can actually upload or take photographs yourself and make your own lists of words. So you're not just stuck with what it gives you out of the package. And there's so many science and math. And Tana Robinson and I were just brainstorming all kinds of different things that you could do with it that I think would be...
And I would guess that they're likely going to develop more
with
the same platform. So
we signed up to be beta testers for when they come out with new apps.
Cool.
So
that's what we do.
We're really excited about that. And then the other really cool thing that we found when we were exploring, we were talking to Karen Mayhall about the Osmo. She told us about
Anki.
Thank you.
to a kid out at Eagle Cliffs yesterday who has one, and he was describing all the things it does and how he can program the cars to do different tactics and stuff. And every car has its own unique traits and unique skills, so you can buy cars that are built for agility, or ones that are built for speed, or ones that can actually hack into the tactics of another car and disrupt it. So it's going to be really awesome.
Yeah, there's a lot of people are thinking about fitness and with, you know, updates to phones and the health kit and the new iOS 8. You know, wearable fit products are kind of a big deal.
I have a Fitbit on. It is like a pedometer to track how far you go, how far you walk, but it's on your wrist, and so you can't bump it off. You can't like accidentally register steps that you're not taking, that sort of thing. And it helps you keep track of your exercise and encourages you to keep going, and keeps track of what you eat and helps you make good choices. There's an app that goes with it, and the app, you put your food in, what you eat, and it keeps track of how many calories you can have per day versus how much weight you want to lose. Measures anytime you are just walking, or if you increase your heart rate at all, it can pick that up as well. It can track your sleep pattern. It can tell you how many times you are awake at night, how long you're awake. It'll tell the difference between actually getting up out of bed versus just kind of tossing and turning a little bit. So it keeps track of a lot of different things to help you keep your health in check.
Have you guys seen those Livescribe pens?
No, I haven't.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
What I learned about Livescribe was because I was taking a qualitative research class through MSU as working towards my doctorate program, and the professor there brought in Livescribe as a means of recording data so that you could use it to track and analyze your qualitative data. The project that I did was visiting with the teachers at my school at the time about how they felt the efficacy of Indian Education for All was in terms of creating a sense of connection and identity for the kids and a sense of belonging at the school, and if they felt like it was effective in doing anything in terms of raising achievement for these kids. So my piece was interviewing a handful, I want to say, if I remember right, about six teachers, and sitting down and going through them with a list of interview questions. And the way the Livescribe works is as I was jotting down notes, which were basically keywords in my notebook, and instead of having to do it word for word, you don't have to do that with the Livescribe. You write down keywords, and then at the same time, you're audio recording what that person is saying. And the way the notebook works is if you touch on different parts of the notebook at the bottom of the notebook page, it will start your recording, end your recording, you can adjust your volume. If you touch on a particular word that you took down as a note, it will automatically take you to that point in the audio and play back what the person was saying at that point in the interview. Plus, whatever notes you take, you can connect wirelessly to your computer, and it will put them on your computer as if it were a notebook page, you know, as if you've been keeping notes in a college class or something. I do know there's also another one that's another form of the Livescribe, and it has a different name, but it's created specifically for people with dyslexia. And as they write it in their own words, it will actually auto-correct the words for them and spell them correctly. So when a person is writing and they're getting their, you know, words, letters backwards or whatever, it auto-corrects for them. Just to be able to have that right there made it so much easier. It allows you to be far more interactive with the person that you're talking to, mm-hmm. and it allows you to pay more attention to the detail of what your purpose is for that interaction, as opposed to getting bogged down in the graphic. I'm sure there are a lot of other components that go with that, but in terms of me having to go back and go through the audio over and over and over again in order to do an analysis so that I could pick out common themes and be able to design my paper into an organized format to get different perspectives about different issues. It was perfect because you literally had everything that was said at your fingertips.
And it actually captures your writing.
Oh, cool.
Digitally. So when you take notes and you're somewhere, or you're journaling or whatever, as you're writing, it'll actually capture it digitally.
Cool.
And then you can actually have your writing in a document. You guys going to get an iPhone 6?
I don't know. I sold my 4. And it's doing pretty okay for me.
I wish for you that you would get an iPhone 6.
I bet you guys do wish I had an iPhone 6.
I'll give you my 5.
I'm good with my 4. I really like my
4.
Yeah. None of us are Android users, but why is that?
Well, I love my Nexus 7. I don't know. My next phone might be an Android.
I've had Android phones, and
What would you say if somebody was looking to get a new phone or whatever for Christmas? What would be the advantage of having one over the other, using both? What do you like better?
I think the cost. And then I just like that the Android is so seamless with the Google Drive, since that's we're so Google-based here in our district.
And I think the Android phones aren't as, I guess, for lack of a better term, locked down. You know, there's more developers who can put things out there. It doesn't have to...
Which is the very reason I prefer my iPhone, because everything is vetted a little bit more. And it's all right there. With the iPhone, I think it's so easy to navigate through, and it's not... I feel like with my Android that I had before, I was having to go into folders and folders and find where I put things. So I really like the simplicity of that.
Hello?
What is a phablet?
Well, it's the idea that people are watching more video content is how they sort of came about. So we wanted phones getting smaller, and now they're actually going back to larger sizes for better viewing experience of a lot of video content. So the word comes from phone and tablet. Not quite a phone, not quite a tablet, somewhere in between. It's a phablet. So.
It makes me wonder, though, are they going to have to redesign clothing to get the pockets bigger?
They'll have to be more elastic or...
Or the slots in your purse where you put your phone won't fit in there anymore. Do you guys know anybody who has a GoPro camera?
I have that student of mine, Zach Murray.
Yeah, so how does he use it?
All the time he makes short films all the time. He uses it when we have guest speakers. He's even put it on his dog's collar and created little videos. And it's pretty cool because you actually control it from your phone. So the GoPro could be on your friend's helmet skiing. And then you can see everything that your friend is doing. So Zach Murray's just a little stud muffin with it.
We were able to use GoPro cameras when we went on our 20-year cruise to Alaska.
Oh, cool.
We went zip lining, and so we had the GoPro cameras on. So what's this Raspberry Pi that I hear of?
So... there's kind of these little kits that you can get to make basic computers. It's kind of the matchup of the coding movement and people getting into coding. And then just the really inexpensive hardware to get a basic, you know, computer that actually does things. And so people who tinker and just hobbyists can kind of throw together their own little computer.
Mm-hmm.
Some systems called Raspberry Pi. And there are others. But just little computers you can get to do something. I saw an article that had... a car system, like make your own touchscreen from your car and have it run on the Raspberry Pi system.
This is a Raspberry Pi. It's a credit card sized computer that costs around £25, designed to teach young people to program, and is capable of doing all kinds of wonderful things. Back in the 80s, kids had to learn how to code computers to use them, and as a result, these kids grew up with an inbuilt understanding of how computers work. Now, we need more programmers than ever before. So to deal with this problem, some clever people came up with the Raspberry Pi to reignite the spark. It runs Linux, a free operating system from an SD card, just like the one in your digital camera, and it's powered by a USB phone charger. You just plug in a mouse and a keyboard, connect it to a TV or monitor, and you're ready to go. In schools, not only is Raspberry Pi a great way to learn programming skills as part of ICT, there are also dozens of cross-curricular applications, like science, and music. And all over the world, people are experimenting with Raspberry Pis and attending Raspberry Jam events, where people of all ages are learning what can be done with a Raspberry Pi. Since the first Raspberry Pi was shipped, we've seen examples of people using the Pi in a variety of amazing and interesting projects. Taking advantage of its size, portability, cost, programmability, and connectability, So whether you want to learn to make games, build robots, or even teach a bear to parachute, with Raspberry Pi, the sky's the limit.
My son actually has a Raspberry Pi, and I've seen it. It's tiny. I still don't even fully know or understand what it does, but he's taking programming classes and using it for all kinds of different things, so I'm sure I'll be impressed when he gets rich someday. We've had Google Drive for many years now in the district, and Google Slides. There's a class out in the Heights that they were taking Google Slides and making interactive quizzes out of them.
Okay, show me what you're doing. Can you explain the project to me?
So we're supposed to do, we pick an animal and we do a quiz about it. And right now I'm trying to fix it by inserting links and stuff.
That's pretty high tech for a little kid.
Yeah, but somebody's got to do it. There's not like a magical robot that can do it for you.
That's true. Can you present a tiny bit of it to me and show it just how it works?
Sure. Just real quick.
So you're linking parts of your slide to other slides in the presentation, okay? So start at the beginning. Look at you navigating that feeling of us. Okay, what am I? Click. Do I have Russia or Greenland? I will say Greenland. Oh, wrong. Try again. Can I live in Russia? What do you think about this project? Is it fun?
Yeah.
Have you learned a lot?
Yeah.
So it's an ordinary old tool, but they've tweaked it and kind of are using it in a new way. So as all of these gadgets and products are kind of becoming more and more in use, it'll be fun to see how they end up being used in new and different and more exciting ways. But one of the things that we've been experimenting with is different forms of presentations. Mm-hmm. One of them is Emaze.
Yeah, so Emaze is kind of I guess I'd call it the crossroads between, say, Prezi, which has a lot of, you know, sweeping and swooping and swirling, and PowerPoint, so a presentation that still has those nice transitions, but it's kind of locked down a little bit more and easier to follow and move along with. So I worked with John Amundsen's sixth grade class and the sixth graders at Burlington to make some presentations.
Emaze.com for making our presentation.
Yeah, we've just been using Emaze to make our Emaze presentation.
I thought it was like really cool how you can like edit it as many times as you want. And even after you share, I think you can still go in and edit it too.
I like that you could pick like the different templates, and each one had different effects on it, and some had more than others. And that was really cool, because if you wanted like a really crazy presentation with a ton of effects, you could pick a different template, or if you didn't want any effects, they had ones with hardly any.
Like, I like that, like how you could pick the templates, because depending on like what like template you pick, you could pick one where like it was like fun, and probably like if you're making a presentation for younger kids for them to look at, and then there's more like mature ones and serious ones. And I like it actually better than the PowerPoint on Google Drive, because there's all those effects that you can do.
It was actually pretty easy to use because it's like that, and when you put your mouse over each like thing at the top of like the toolbar, I guess, it just tells what it is. So when you click on it, you don't know, it won't take you to like some random place. You know exactly where you're going.
You can access it at home if you have internet. You can use it on a tablet or other mobile device too.
I guess what I did when I first sort of started was like I looked at a couple templates actually, which like so you can find like what you want and see how like all the effects, because some of them don't have effects or not as much, so you can see exactly what you want. I love how there's so many. So sort of spend some time looking at what you want, seeing how stuff works.
Just kind of like play around with it for a little bit, and then once you know what you're doing, you can start doing your presentation or whatever.
I think you should know exactly what you're going to do your presentation on and not like right in the middle say you want to switch it because you've already put a lot of time into it, so just know for sure what you're going to do.
When you pick your theme, it's like categorized, like you can have like sort of like, it's like categorized like artistic, kind of like sporty, knowledgeable, all kinds.
Like if your template doesn't go with your theme, then you can always just pick another one that does fit what you're doing.
Well, nothing like with me for computers is really easy at first, but it came way easier than any other site I've used for presentations, and I would use it in the future.
They really, once they got the hang of it, they were all over it, so they liked that. But it was different than slides, because they'd had some, you know, experience and exposure to that, but that they could have these cool themes and templates that kind of did things,
mm-hmm.
just fun.
Emaze is a great online tool to create jazzy presentations. When you initially go to emaze.com, it prompts you to sign in. I've already got an account, so instead of signing up again, I'm going to choose login and log into my account. We'll just pan from left to right here. When we look on the left side, we can show all presentations we've created, any that we've kept private, and any that we've published out there on the web. Scrolling across the top, we can see my presentations, any presentations that have been shared with me. I have none right now. And then I can also explore presentations others have made, and they've made them public. I'm going to go ahead and go back to mine. And I'm just going to keep panning across the top, and here we have an import from PowerPoint, which is a great option to just add a little bit of jazz. You can create a new one by pressing new or create new presentation here. Once you press create new presentation, you get to choose your design. The designs are really, really fun. So you can just choose whatever you might like. I am really digging this classroom presentation one. I'm going to choose that. And it basically takes you to your template. On the left-hand side, it's extremely similar to PowerPoint in that you can add slides. The slides have different templates and built-in animation. So as you can see, as I'm adding slides here, it's showing me what it will be animated like when the students change it. A great feature in Emaze is the ease of inserting videos. All you have to do is put your little video right inside this pre-made template and you're ready to go. You have editing options all along the top here, under each icon. One of Charles' favorite features is the chart feature within Emaze. So our students have a really nice way to incorporate data into their presentations. When you're finished, you can press save. It sometimes will automatically save for you. And voila, you've just created an email.
I was out at Inger Tognetti's class, 6th grade, 5th grade combo out at Big Sky, and they were talking about techie gadgets either that they had or that maybe they wanted for the holidays, and they made some posters using one of my new favorite tools, Canva.
Thank you.
on with our Face of Education contest or prize drawing. We again checking to see if you have your actual picture as part of your profile for your Google account and your D2 apps. And I pick a random school, then I pick a random staff member from that school with a name picker, and if you have your face there, you're going to win a prize. What you should also know is that all of those names that win will go into a larger drawing, so definitely worth getting your picture up there. In the long term, it's also great to help out when we're emailing and trying to figure out who's who, and when students share things with us. Mm-hmm. It's really important to have that face there, that so we can see who's doing what. It's just that recognition. It's just a good professional presence.
We had a conversation the other day with a group of teachers who weren't fully understanding why they should do that. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that they were worried about was they don't really want their face out there because of facial recognition and stuff. But really, because of facial recognition, it's good for our students to know that they are emailing the correct person.
Right. And so our winner for this go-around is Ms. Trollope at Eagle Cliff. So, and here's the thing, she was the first pick and the first face. So other schools, I've had to go through like 6 or 7 names before I finally find a staff member that has a picture with their profile. So, congratulations.
Good job, Genevieve.
Thanks for making my job quicker and easier when I was picking through those.
So what do we have coming up next year? We're almost there.
I know, wow. Mm-hmm.
What do you guys have on your lists?
Well, we definitely are going to get into coding more, as I know we know a lot of you did the Hour of Code as part of Computer Science Education Week. But we want to kind of, it can happen anytime. And so we want to kind of ring in the new year with an event that we host and sort of sponsor at the district level. So stay tuned for that. We'll have more details to come about that. We hope that you can send some of your students to that event and volunteer or find volunteers as well.
Fire Wednesday, still going on at MSU Billings.
Mm-hmm.
Some classes through adult education will be popping up, so if you just check those out.
Yep. We want to really make sure, too, that we get everybody on board as far as Google. We want to know what you know, what you want to know, what you still need to know, what kind of trainings that we can offer, and how to best get that delivered to you. So we've got some good things coming up for that, too.
Mm-hmm.
So our next
show... you just finished. Now you're certified.
Yeah, so we've got...
totally cool.
2 out of 3 of us
two-thirds.
Are Google certified teachers, one on the way. So we have all kinds of fun things in store. And using those skills for our next show, we'll be talking about how to take that classroom stuff that you know and manage it with some of the technology that we have. So be looking forward to that. But you guys, Merry Christmas.
Yeah. I can't believe it's that time.
I know. See you next year.